Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to address your audience. Expressing solidarity with those people around the world who are less fortunate than we are here in Switzerland is an important aspect of our humanitarian tradition. It is also a constitutional mandate and an important aspect of our foreign policy. And I'm very pleased to say that the Swiss Agency for Development and Cooperation does a very good job in fulfilling this mandate with a high degree of effectiveness, professionalism, and integrity. Our main objective in our work at the SDC is to alleviate poverty around the world, but we try to do so in a way that does not harm the increasingly fragile balance of our ecological system. A big portion of our assistance goes to Africa. There we support local governments and civil societies in their efforts to improve the economic situation, to improve the health situation, and also to improve the skills of the workforce, to lift up the economy. Africa has come a long way in addressing many of its challenges, but progress is somewhat uneven, and much remains to be done to lift all corners of the continent out of poverty. Of course, the African governments and civil societies are leading the charge in this effort, but agencies such as the SDC has a lot to offer in helping in these efforts.
Till now, are you satisfied with the global response to the situation in Africa as a continent?
Thank you very much. And I think, yes, I am satisfied in the sense that the awareness has been raised sufficiently enough for African countries and leadership in Africa to understand this is a problem they need to address. So the normative framework is there. At the African level, you know that the African Union has a gender policy, which says that 50% of all appointments in the African Union has to be women. I think the challenge is how do you turn this normative framework at the country level to make sure that the decisions that are taken in the continent in each and every country is reflective of what's have agreed at the international level. So I think that's where the gap is, and that is the reason why we're working very closely with various African governments individually to turn these resolutions into solutions on their country, signing agreements with them, like as I mentioned, with the Democratic Republic of Congo, in the Central African Republic, in Somalia, in South Sudan, to encourage the leadership of those countries to be able to make sure they deal with this problem. So I think our job is to support the African women. We cannot address this problem if we don't have sufficient number of women in leadership positions. We don't have a lot of women in the parliaments. You know, in Nigeria, for example, in the Senate and in the House, we don't have a lot of women in the police. We don't have more women in the military forces. We don't have a lot of women as magistrates and judges. I think that is what is important. Until you are able to have that large number of women in positions of authority, then the mindset will not be changed. And we have to work with the media to understand this is very serious. We have to work with civil society, and we have to work with religious leaders to understand this is a moral issue. So it's still a huge challenge, but basically, by and large, the word is there. And I think African leadership have realized it, they have accepted it, and approved it at the African Union.
Thank you very much, Mayo.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I'm very happy to welcome all here at the Cinematte. I'm Ursula Keller, and I'm the Senior Gender Policy Advisor at the Swiss Agency for Cooperation and Development. And I will guide you through this afternoon. The topic we are to discuss is sexual violence and gender-based violence and conflict, and the legacy and consequences such crimes and violations have for victims and their families, but also for the wider processes of post-conflict transformation, sustainable development, and peace. We will start the afternoon with the welcome address by Manuel Sager, Director General of the Swiss Agency for Development and Cooperation, and two contributions of our distinguished guests and speakers today, the Under Secretary General and Special Representative on Sexual Violence and Conflict, Zainab Bangura, and Dr. Monika Hauser, executive board member and founder of Medica Mondiale. They will set the scene for the discussion with our four panelists, all experts and partners of Switzerland's international cooperation. We will reserve time for questions and answers at the end of the panel. You will then also have the opportunity to ask questions to our keynote speakers, Mrs. Bangura, Mrs. Hauser. After the panel at 4 o'clock, you are all invited to join us for the reception. And finally, for those who can even spare more time with us, at 5 o'clock, we invite you to the Swiss premiere of the new Kosovo film, Three Windows and a Hanging. This film will be introduced then by Iqbal Rogova from the Kosovo Women's Network. Unfortunately, I have to inform you that Dalia Abdelhamid, who is on the program to be with us on the panel from Egypt, is not among us. She had to cancel her travel on short notice. Luckily, however, we get Iqbal Rogova. She has agreed to be with us on the panel. So, but now, let's listen to our speakers. And I'm particularly happy now to introduce you to Manuel Sager, our new Director General. Please, Mr. Sager.
Thank you, Ursula Keller. Madam Special Representative Bangura, Dr. Hauser, Excellencies, distinguished guests, I would like to extend also on behalf of my colleagues at the SDC who are sprinkled around the room this afternoon, a very warm welcome to this event. I'm greatly encouraged by this impressive turnout, particularly since the topic is certainly a difficult one. Nicholas Kristof and Cheryl Woodun, in their most unsettling book, which appeared in 2009, Half the Sky, have remarked that in the 19th century, the principal moral fight, principal moral challenge was slavery. In the 20th century, it was the fight against totalitarianism. And they said they suspect that in the 21st century, it will be the struggle for women's equality. What with the topic that we are discussing this afternoon, the struggle against gender-based violence, is part of the struggle for women's equality in societies at large. Rape and other forms of gender-based violence in conflict and wars have been a feature of any wars for centuries now. And sadly enough, it is a crime that we continue to witness in today's conflicts. But I would argue, and I'm not the only one, of course, that while over the centuries we have witnessed violence against women as a sad and terrific phenomenon in armed conflicts, that there was a watershed, if you will, or a milestone, a sad milestone in the 90s with the war in the Balkans and also in Rwanda and Burundi, where violence against women actually became a method of war, became a weapon to terrorize the civil population, to terrorize women, and to discourage them. I think that was a watershed in the conduct of armed conflict in general, and it also it was a wake-up call for society, and it became clear that something needed to be done to stop this. In 1998, the Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court was adopted. It was the first international treaty to identify crimes against women as war crimes and crimes against humanity. Furthermore, in 2000, the Security Council adopted Resolution 1325 on Women, Peace, and Security, which explicitly demands that all parties to a conflict protect women and girls from any form of gender-based violence. Next year, for the 15th anniversary of this resolution, a high-level review will critically assess where we stand in the implementation of our commitments according to the resolution. The statistics of gender-based violence in armed conflicts are shocking, but these statistics only tell part of the story. There's behind every victim, there is devastating consequences for the lives of those men, women, and women, girls, and men and boys, affecting their physical, psychological, social, and economic well-being. Being a victim means facing stigma, shame, rejection by husbands, families, and communities. Impunity is widespread, and seeking justice is hard since legal systems in war-torn societies are generally weak, and prosecution procedures may expose survivors to further humiliation and re-victimization. Moreover, such violence does disrupt communities and can destroy for a very long time the basis for peace and reconciliation in a society. How do we respond to these complexities of gender-based violence? This is the topic we would like to explore further this afternoon. We are very proud to have been able to gather a number of distinguished experts to join us in our reflections. I'm particularly honored to welcome Special Representative Zaina Hava Bangura, Undersecretary General and Special Representative of the Secretary General on Sexual Violence and Conflict. In this latter position, Ms. Bangura holds the international community accountable and reminds us that sexual violence is categorically prohibited under international law, and she makes sure that such atrocities receive not only our outrage, but also our vigorous response. I'm also very pleased to welcome Dr. Monica Hauser, Executive Board Member and founder of Medica Mondiale, a women's rights organization that has supported victims of gender-based violence in war context for more than 20 years. Before giving the floor to Ms. Bangura and Ms. Hauser, allow me to give you a few highlights of Switzerland's commitment to end sexual and gender-based violence in conflicts. In its current message to Parliament, we call it message, you would probably call it something else, it's a helvetism, I guess, to Parliament on development and cooperation, the Swiss government has made a commitment to substantially increasing its engagement in fragile states. Women and girls in these contexts are at particular risk of experiencing violence, either as direct targets or as particularly vulnerable groups as refugees or internally displaced people. Protection from sexual and gender-based violence in fragile contexts is an important aspect of Switzerland's foreign policy. Let me give you a few examples. In 2007, Switzerland was among the first countries to adopt the National Action Plan on the implementation of UN Security Council 1325 on women, peace, and security, with the overall aim to, first, strengthen participation of women in peace-building and post-conflict transformation, and second, to protect women's rights and prevent sexual and gender-based violence. Furthermore, Switzerland just released the Action Plan on the Protection of Children Associated with Armed Conflicts, with armed groups, where the plight of girl soldiers receives particular attention. Within the new post-2015 development framework, Switzerland firmly promotes a standalone goal on gender equality with a strong target on ending violence against women and girls in all its forms. Switzerland spends about 25 million francs per year supporting programs to prevent violence against women. The majority in conflict and post-conflict regions such as the DRC, Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, Afghanistan, Tajikistan, Nepal, the occupied Palestinian territories, and the Western Balkans. In the Great Lakes region, SDC was among the first 8 agencies to provide swift and direct support for victims of sexual violence in early 2000. In close partnership with dedicated civil society organizations, Switzerland supported the establishment of medical care, psychological and legal counseling services, and developed innovative community-based programs for violence prevention in the three countries around the Great Lakes. We will hear more about these efforts from Ursula Sales in the following panel discussion. Switzerland also supports the Afghan Independent Human Rights Commission, which conducted a national inquiry into rape and honor killings and thus sheds light on an area that had long been taboo. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, from these efforts to end sexual and all forms of gender-based violence, three lessons have emerged. First, prevention is key. For starters, that means strengthening the rights of women and girls and empowering them to exercise those rights. It also means sensitizing men and boys to gender equality and violence prevention. Second, women have to be included as equals in all efforts of post-conflict transformation, peace building, and state building. Third, and this is our biggest challenge, we have to combat widespread impunity for these atrocities. On November 25th, on the International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women, the international community will raise its voice and call for an end to violence that affects and is estimated 1 in 3 women in her lifetime. I urge you, governments, civil society, and the UN, to join the call and, more importantly, to take action. Christoph and Dunn, in their, they took the book title, Half the Sky, from the Chinese proverb you might be familiar with, women lift up half the sky. We must take our mission, or we must take our mission seriously to empower women and to enable them to fulfill this role, to lift up half the sky. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Mr. Sager, for these introductory words and for clearly demonstrating and reaffirming the Swiss commitments in this field as well. We now turn to our next speaker. I'm very honored to present to you Mrs. Zainab Bangura. Mrs. Bangura, you have been appointed a special representative of the Secretary General on Sexual Violence and Conflict in 2012. Since then, you have been traveling extensively to countries in conflict, documenting violation of women's human rights in these contexts. So you will present us now some key messages from your latest reports to Secretary General. So please, Mrs. Bangura.
Thank you very much. Excellencies, Mr. Director General, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I am honored to address you today as we gather to discuss sexual violence and its legacy for post-conflict transformation, sustainable development, and peace. I would like to express my gratitude to the Swiss government and to the Swiss Agency for Development and Cooperation for the tremendous support they lend to the conflict-related sexual violence agenda, as well as the broader women, peace, and security agenda, as you just heard from the DG. Our in-depth collaboration continues this week as the government of Switzerland hosts a donor conference for the network which I chair, United Nations Action Against Sexual Violence in Conflict. Because my mandate was created by a Security Council resolution, a subsequent resolution a year later requested the Secretary General to present an annual report to the Security Council that describes the progress that has been made and continues to be made and the colossal challenges that remain in the struggle to end conflict-related sexual violence. This year's report covered 21 countries of concern in Europe, Asia, Africa, South America, and the Middle East. The report shows that this truly is a global crime. It also makes recommendation for how the countries in question and the international community can prevent and respond to these atrocities. The report identified 34 armed groups credibly suspected of rape and other forms of sexual violence in conflict. These groups include militias and rebel groups, but also government security forces. We also report on a number of alarming threats and challenges. With regard to the fight against impunity, while there has been some progress in numerous countries, the perpetrators who commit this heinous crime almost never face justice. We must ensure that perpetrators are not enabled by inadequate peace agreements and security sector reform that do not take sexual violence into account. It is also crucial that we protect survivors and others who are pursuing justice. Perpetrators should never walk free because victims are too afraid to testify or they are threatened with reprisal and violence. Furthermore, many survivors still lack access to the basic services they need to rebuild their lives. The UN therefore calls on the countries in question and the international community to ensure that men, women, and children who are victims of sexual violence and children born of rape get the assistance they need. This year's report of the Secretary General also explores the link between sexual violence and the economic drivers of war. Armed groups use rape strategically to gain control of territories with valuable natural resources, including minerals used in the manufacturing of cars, cell phones, and other products sold around the world. I applaud the countries and the companies taking steps to address this. The international community should now ensure that these best practices become the norm and not the exception. The report also documents the role sexual violence plays as a trigger for mass flights in some conflict, as families flee to escape the threat of wartime rape. This flight further exposes people to sexual violence as perpetrators prey on the vulnerability and displays. Sexual violence also stems from the harmful coping mechanism of parents trying to protect their daughters through early or forced marriage to older men. In some cases, the vulnerability of displaced civilians has led to human trafficking and slavery. The UN therefore urges member states to consider accepting sexual violence in conflict as a form of prosecution that should lead to the recognition of refugee status for the individuals affected. However, among all the horrors depicted in this crime, we also find glimmers of hope. On the international arena, there is now undeniable political momentum backing national efforts to prevent a response to this crime. More and more governments, NGOs, and activists are standing up and saying enough is enough. Some of examples in this change at the national level include Colombia, where the government is training security forces to prevent and respond to sexual violence, and efforts are underway to ensure reparation for survivors. In the DRC, an increasing number of suspected perpetrators are being prosecuted, including members of the national security forces. Special police units have been formed to deal specifically with crimes of sexual violence, and the president has recently appointed a special representative to deal specifically with this issue. In Somalia, the president has made commitments that alleged rape victims will no longer be in prison, and that a specialized crime unit and dedicated clinic will be created to deal with cases of sexual violence. I have traveled to numerous conflicts and post-conflict countries, and I have met with survivors and their families from all over the world. The pain they felt was tangible, and their stories were heartbreaking. I saw rape victims as young as 6 months old, and had stories of elderly victims in their 70s. I met a father in Somalia whose 4 and 6 year old daughters were raped. I spoke with men from Bosnia who had been sexually abused in detention during the Bosnian War. When you meet the survivors and hear their stories, you know that one rape in war is one too many. It is my hope that this year's report of the General on Sexual Violence in Conflict will be a useful tool to countries working to combat this problem, and for the international community to galvanize action and maintain the momentum we have gained in the last 3 years. It is only with the commitment of national governments, with the support of international partners, that we can hope to finally eradicate what has long been called history's oldest and least condemned crime. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Bangura, for your words, for sharing these findings with us. I may recall just two important points from your presentation. First, that you mentioned that sexual violence is more often strategically used to gain control of territories for economic exploitation and often plays as a trigger for mass flights. I think these findings are worrying, and that really demands the international community and all of us to assume particular responsibility. And the second point is also there are glimmers of hope, and there is political momentum for backing national efforts in several countries. So I think it's important that we can all build on these and support those countries in their struggle. So thank you again for your presentation. I'm very happy now to present to you our third speaker, Dr. Monika Hauser. You've been traveling in the 90s as a young gynecologist right into the war-torn area in Bosnia-Herzegovina after you have heard reports about mass rapes. And together with local psychologists and doctors, you opened the first women's therapy center. Meanwhile, more than 20 years later, Medica Mondiale is an established and well-respected women's human rights organization working in many countries affected by conflict. You have received many awards, among them the Right Livelihood Award, which is also known as the Alternative Nobel Prize, which you have received in 2008. Medica Mondiale has recently conducted a study asking about the long-term consequences of sexual violence and what the support by Medica Mondiale meant to those women that were clients in the center in Bosnia more than 20 years back. We are now very keen to hear what your findings are and what are the lessons of 21 years of working with survivors of wartime violence. Please, Mrs. Hauser, yours the floor.
Thank you very much, dear Ms. Bangura, Mr. Sager, Ms. Keller, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure for me to speak to you today, and I want to thank you very much for the invitation today. Let me start with some personal remarks. As you said, at the end of 92, as a still young gynecologist, I went to Central Bosnia in order to see where I could help to build up concrete and meaningful support to survivors of sexualized violence. My anger and my solidarity met the energy of Bosnian professional women, and together we founded the first women's therapy center, Medica Senica, in April 93. Right from the start, we were working with an integrated approach. This means we were providing medical and psychosocial assistance along with income-generating measures. And due to the insights we gained from our practical work, we always supplemented this with public awareness raising and political human rights work. Since then, Medica Senica, what got an independent organization after some years, Medica Senica has provided support to tens of thousands of traumatized women and girls. This is a very great achievement for the organization. But it means also that for over 20 years, the colleagues have been dealing with financial and security as well as the destructive consequences which this violence continues to have in the post-war context. I am very pleased to hear that the director of Medica Senica of today, Sabiha Husic, is being presented with the 2014 Women of the World Award this month in New York. So it was in the Bosnian city of Senica in 93 that the foundations were laid for the active and practical commitments to women rights of the organization Medica Mondiale. This involvement has now spread to more than 20 project countries, including Kosovo, Afghanistan, Democratic Republic of Congo, and Liberia. In our projects, we aim to establish long-term structures, so providing relevant training for local staff is one of the most important investments we can make. And we have drawn up standards for a trauma-sensitive approach to counseling and project work. As we understand it, trauma-sensitive means much more than just being aware of the consequences which a traumatic experience such as sexualized violence can have on the way the affected women feel, think, and experience this world. A trauma-sensitive approach also means strengthening the ability of women and girls to exit the powerlessness they felt during the traumatic experience, shape their own lives, and actively participate in reorganization and peacekeeping measures in their societies. Sexualized violence is a social problem. It is the most outrageous manifestation of gender inequality in patriarchal societies. Especially in conflict and post-conflict settings, it has garnered increasing attention since the 90s, when knowledge of the monstrously high numbers of women raped during the war in Bosnia and the genocide in Rwanda reached the public. Women activists around the world have been fighting for decades to have this recognized as a serious violation of human rights and a war crime. But furthermore, the double injustice, as we call it, has to be made visible. Firstly, women suffer the violence itself, but secondly, because violence was inflicted upon them, they then suffer social exclusion and stigmatization, are forced to remain silent by their own communities, and are expected to feel shame and disgrace as a survivor. Also, it is surely the perpetrators who should feel this. Worldwide, in both war-torn and non-war regions, an intolerably low number of perpetrators are pursued and brought to justice. One of the most important tasks we face is to break the continuity of violence at different levels. And sexualized wartime violence is also a political problem. In spite of the very useful UN resolutions such as 1325 and 8020, men, regardless of affiliation and rank, continue to rape unabated. At present, just today, we can see it in Syria, northern Iraq, South Sudan, Democratic Republic of Congo, and so on. And despite the very commendable initiative launched by William Hague, I do have to warn of the risks of treating violence, sexual violence, primarily only as a weapon of war. This narrow focus makes it very difficult to appreciate the complex dynamics of this specific form of patriarchal violence. This type of violence is only worthy of true credibility if it begins to look for the roots of this violence also, and also in the Western patriarchal structures, and makes the connection between sexualized violence in war and non-war. And this would mean, for example, that peacekeepers receive appropriate training before they are sent on missions, ensuring they have had to reflect on their own images of masculinity. Another totally unacceptable situation also needs to be tackled. It is still the case that women make up barely 5% of the delegates at peace negotiations, in spite of the fact that women activists all over the world are keeping the struggle for peace alive under very dangerous conditions. It is the women rights activists in these very countries, as my old friend Igor Rogova, for example, in these very countries we designate as fragile states, who have to deal every day with the devastating effects of male violence and try to restore the will to live in countless women and girls. These women, and many activists can call them, and many of these women can call themselves activists and survivors in the same time. These women are performing courageous development work and actively defending the values we cherish so clearly in the West. And sexualized violence is an enormous public health problem which affects the whole society in many different ways. In order to illustrate the massive and long-term consequences of conflict-related sexualized violence, today I would like to report on a study which we recently concluded. The title of the study is "We Are Still Alive. We Have Been Harmed, But We Are Brave and Strong." The study includes first-hand reports from survivors on the long-term consequences in Bosnia-Herzegovina, conducted as a joint project between Medica Mondiale and Medica Senica. The study investigates the effects of sexualized wartime violence on the life and relationships of the survivors after 20 years, as well as the strategies they employ to cope. And it is the only one of the very few studies, not only, but one of the very few studies worldwide to look into the effects of trauma on war survivors. Our study reveals a complex picture of the traumatic experiences with their extremely destructive consequences, even 20 years afterwards. So now we have statistics to back up what we have known since long time. For example, some figures. 57% of these women are still suffering from a post-traumatic stress disorder. 40% report frequently thinking of death and dying. 70% of the women indicate that even today their lives are completely shaped by the rapes. Above all, they have troubling memories, anxiety, and other emotional problems, and severe problems in close relationships. 85% are receiving regular medical treatment. 65% of the women regularly take medicine, half of them continuously since the end of the war, and for 91%, these are psychopharmaceuticals. And 10% of the women developed carcinomas. Children are very much affected. 58% of the participants in the study claim that rape has affected their children, including children who are under medical and or psychiatric treatment. This shows how strongly these traumas are carried over into the next generation. However, this study also reveals the strength of these women. 68% of the women describe their experiences of personal growth due to overcoming trauma. This strength is even more remarkable if we consider the prejudices and exclusion they have to confront within their communities. So it is of essential importance to break these social taboos in order to help survivors to cope, especially since we know that self-blame poses a great obstacle to the women's recovery. Our research also has the goal of bringing the survivors into contact with their own resources and thus empowering them. This deliberately works in the opposite direction to self-blame and social discrimination, which both reinforce their victim status. The expert and solidaric support provided by Medica Senica for so many years was named in the interviews as being very important in helping them to cope within their traumas, deal with the everyday problems, and simply give them a new will to live. So the effects of the positive experiences can also be still be felt today. It is fundamentally important to note that key characteristics of the approach of the Medica Senica staff are solidarity and respect. For these reasons, I would like to conclude with four main demands. Apply a trauma-sensitive approach to all interventions related to sexualized gender-based violence. A trauma-sensitive approach has to take into account certain basic principles in dealing with people who have experienced violence. Second, address the continuum of sexualized gender-based violence before, during, and after conflict. Sustainable strategies to prevent and eliminate this form of violence are most successful when tackling root causes and promoting gender equality in post-war societies. Third, commit to long-term funding for holistic programs to support survivors, including psychosocial and health services, legal systems, economic benefits, and income-generating projects. Dealing with violent experiences on the individual level and bringing about changes on the social level both take a great deal of time. Therefore, long-term commitment is very necessary. And fourth, adopt a community-based approach, what is also a very important prevention measure. Feminist aid interventions want more than just to improve the functioning. Again, the good functioning of those women who are lucky enough to meet a helper. They want to end the structural oppression that affects all levels of women's lives. The daily work in Bosnia, Afghanistan or Liberia shows us clearly we still need to share the pain with the survivors because the consequences of violence are far from over. The UN and the international community have organized many important conferences, sent many consultants, established many important committees, and written an infinite number of papers. But what kind of answers has the community found to address the most pressing questions? And even so, for a long time, wrong answers might have been given for years. We can start today and now by finding the right answers and bringing about change. Our vision is not only about justice for women. It is also the only way to achieve more development and good governance, less violence and destruction, and more inner and outer peace for all of us in this world. In order to achieve the goal, we all have to assume appropriate responsibility, whatever our functions are. We need to do this to honor the dignity of those women and girls who survived violence. And we also need to do it for the sake of our own dignity. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Hauser, for this very intensive and interesting input. I believe you showed us very clearly, or reminded us very clearly again, that dealing with and responding to such violence in conflict is never a short-term task. And it always requires comprehensive approaches and strategies on all levels, on the individual, family, community, as well as on the national, international, political level. So thank you again for your input. I would like once more to thank all three of our speakers for setting the scene, and we would like to move on to our panel discussion. So I now ask our four panelists to take their seats at the table, please. We have heard now about the complexity on dealing with gender-based violence in conflict. and the long-term consequences it has for individuals as well as societies as a whole. So what is now the right thing to do? That is what we would like to explore now in the coming following discussion, to share experiences and discuss challenges and what good practices from the field. This will also serve us as guidance on how we can become more effective in the implementation of our commitments under Resolution 1325 and the Swiss National Action Plan. To do that, we want to highlight four dimensions that seem to be crucial for comprehensive answers to end sexual and all other forms of gender-based violence in conflict and thereafter. First, it's about right approaches in support of victims and survivors and strategies that link comprehensive services and emergency with strategies for empowerment and prevention. What are these good practices and experiences? Second, it's about supporting women's agency and women's participation in all aspects of conflict resolution, peace building, and peace processes, since women are not only victims, but actors in their own right. How can we strengthen women's agency to combat sexual and gender-based violence? That's one of the questions. Third, it's about impunity, finding ways to become more effective in addressing impunity, both on local, national, and international level, which is generally identified as one of the biggest challenges. So how can we do that? And fourth and finally, it's about integrating gender equality and women's rights in post-conflict transformation and state-building processes, since gender issues are often neglected or postponed for later when institutions are rebuilt and laws designed. But how to do that? To discuss these things, I have four very competent panelists with me here on the stage. Very brief introduction on my full on the left is Ursula Salesse, we have heard. She's the project director of the SDC at SDC for the Regional Psychosocial Program in the Great Lakes region. We have on my right Iqbal Rugova. She is the executive director of the Kosovo Women's Network, a multi-ethnic network of 85 women's organizations undertaking joint advocacy initiatives to support, protect, and promote the rights and interests of women and girls throughout Kosovo. Thank you again for stepping in on short notice for our panel. On my left now, Danae van der Straten-Pontos is a consultant on sexual violence and a legal advisor for Trial, Track Impunity Always, which is a Swiss-based non-profit legal organization specializing in the fight against impunity for international crimes, including sexual violence in conflict. And finally, Karen Barnes, to the right. Here is an independent consultant and research associate in politics and governance, in the politics and governance team of the Overseas Development Institute. Previously, Karen worked at the OECD Development Center, and she's the author of several policy and research papers, including the OECD policy paper on gender and state building in fragile and conflict-affected states. So you see, we have extensive experience here. I would like to start now a first question to Ursula concerning what are really the issues and challenges. And we've heard it before, SDC has been very committed in its support to victims of sexual violence in the Great Lakes region and since a long time. We all know that immediate responses in emergencies is key, but SDC has also realized that it is not enough if we want to end violence, in particular in protect conflicts such as the one in the Great Lakes region. So can you outline, Ursula, how your work, what is your approach, and what are the most important lessons you have, please?
Thank you, Ursula. dear other speakers, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I'm honored to participate today to this panel discussion and share experience, lessons learned during my work with the Swiss Development Corporation as a program coordinator in the Great Lake regions more specifically in Rwanda, Burundi, and South Kivu in the eastern DRC. Three countries with different contexts today, considering sexual gender-based violence, but with a common past of violent, long-lasting conflicts and destructive wars, leaving behind destruction and deterioration of social fabric of communities and societies. While in Burundi and Rwanda, rape and sexual violence by armed perpetrators is more or less past, the situation in eastern DRC remains marked by local conflicts with a multitude of armed groups misusing their power towards the most vulnerable. While in South Kivu, from the reported rapes, in 60% the perpetrator is an armed person, the neighboring countries Burundi and Rwanda struggle with a high prevalence of sexual gender-based violence, including rape, where perpetrators are civils coming from the communities, the neighborhood, or inside of the family. This seems, in a way, logical, because where have gone combatants from armed groups when they have been disarmed? They will not change completely their behavior with the act of disarmament. Additionally to this and the fact that in every society sexual gender-based violence exists, the deterioration of the social fabric in societies during years of conflict having devastating effects on social norms and behaviors. The psychosocial program of the Swiss Development Cooperation in the Great Lakes region aims to respond to sexual gender-based violence with a comprehensive psychosocial approach, in addition to medical, individual, psychological, and legal support for survivors, which addresses one part of the problem. The program puts a strong focus on involving the community in treating individual and collective traumas, establishing a base to promote social integration of survivors and addressing and discussing the roots, causes and consequences of sexual gender-based violence to contribute to social cohesion. The community-based psychosocial approach is important to fight against social isolation, stigmatization and rejection of the survivors and helps to reintegrate them into their families and communities and supports the progress from victimization towards empowerment. The involvement of men is important in order to break with the simplest dichotomy of men being seen as perpetrators and women as the survivors. Both men and women have a role to play in society and can have a positive role in overcoming stigma and conflicts. To reach communities and working in communities, the psychosocial program is working with 8 local partner organizations which have trained personnel, facilitators, direct living in the communities, often involved are leaders and members of existing women groups. Besides awareness raising and conscientization workshops, they help to organize discussion in groups for group therapies of survivors, but as well for husbands of survivors or other family members, because we are considering that as well they are affected by this crime to their wives, and they are as well suffering about the violence done. Besides, many of these groups have additional activities. They are gathering together survivors and other women, and they try to organize their life, discussing and rebuilding together organizing as well community activities which have therapeutic effects in addition to generate a small income for the most vulnerable of groups. They support as well communication between survivors and authorities and refer survivors to medical structures. Some partners have integrated as well information and education for rights, more specifically female rights, and organization this through alphabetization activities. The program started in 2011 and has a long vision until 2023, which is an important aspect in terms of behavior change, which needs years. Since 2011, the psychosocial program has accompanied around 35,000 persons, whereof around 30,000 are women. From them, around 46% are survivors of rape. But one of the hugest challenges we are facing in the program is the legal support, especially related to accessibility to legal services and the performance of those services. Even in best case, a condemnation has been achieved, often the protection of the survivor can't be guaranteed by authorities because perpetrators are released from prison after some weeks. While in Rwanda in the last years significant achievements have improved for legal services, social barriers remain very strong, especially in case where the perpetrator is a member of the family. A girl who wants to prosecute her perpetrator if he is coming from the same family has often no support from her surrounding. She's facing various streets. Because if the perpetrator is condemned, the risk is high that his close family requires financial compensation of the girl's family, because he cannot earn money anymore and assure the survival of his close family while being in prison. This is just an example of many other social linked barriers which are hindering access to legal support. These social barriers are even stronger if the crime committed is not rape, but another form of sexual gender-based violence. I would like to address the importance to reflect about how coming from protection or from programs in conflict situation, how moving to programs and situations in post-conflict and development situations. Because various studies have shown that violence, sexual gender-based violence, is not ending after conflict. I think, of course, first recommendation or wish as well, always mentioned by the women in the field, is the ask for peace. So, of course, our strategies should include all aspects supporting peace in these countries. In post-conflict and development context, we should avoid vertical projects and parallel structures, focusing only on survivors. There is a risk of double stigmatization. We should try to integrate, for example, medical care for survivors in existing health facilities. The same thing is as well to combat extreme poverty and to support survivors with an economical support. It has been very well discussed how to do this, because if we just support survivors of sexual gender-based violence, we have once more a stigmatization of a certain group of people. So therefore, we ask to include as well in this kind of activities different groups of people, other vulnerable women, even men supporting certain dynamics in economical development. Against impunity, I think we should work on structural level, support to the legal system in terms of good governance, and training. Special session to sexual gender-based violence can be an option where we have made quite good experiences in Burundi. Implication of men. Men should not be excluded. They need a place and role in the society, that they feel important. Empowerment of women needs discussion about roles of women and men, and this discussion can just be done with women and men together. And like this, we can achieve as well strategies for prevention and protection. As last but not least, I think a recommendation is as well to focus on long-term commitment, which can support behavioral changes. And I think to tackle the problems, we have to attack from various sides. Top down, in case of policy, good governance, and bottom up, for all the social integration and aspects of empowerment of women.
Thank you, Ursula, for outlining what can be a comprehensive approach, but also what are still the challenges that you face, mostly also on community level. I would like to give now the second, present you Ego once more, concerning how we can build women's agency and the role of women's participation. Women in Kosovo were actually the first one to actually demand UN Security Council resolution to be implemented in Kosovo in the transition process after the war. You asked for equal participation, representation in all negotiation and peace processes, and you also lobbied to get gender issues included into the negotiation agenda, including accountability for sexual violence committed. Could you outline what were your strategies and experience in this process, what worked and what not, and what you have achieved?
Thank you, Ursula. Yes, before I answer you the question, I need to give a summary of the situation in Kosovo before.
Yes.
So in the 90s, when we were under the occupation, under the regime of Milosevic, we existed in Kosovo as women's rights organization, and we worked together with men in Kosovo to support citizens in different aspects, because the schools were closed in Albania. We had no health care, so we organized through different private clinics. And of course, working with community, same men and women. So we were so organized. It was like Kosovo 10 years was like, the whole Kosovo was like a civil society. Everyone was involved. After the war, we were very excited when we heard that United Nations mission in Kosovo were going to be established. And to be honest, I wish I didn't get excited, because from day one, they themselves didn't implement 1325. On the contrary, they pushed women away from the agenda. So we had to really start from zero. And it was very, very hard struggle to try to convince UNMIC to say implement 1325. And it was so tough that personally I had even health problems. My appendix burst because of stresses. And I got burnout because of this completely ignorance of United Nations Mission Kosovo. But what is worse was that they didn't change, but also when we started to work to bring justice for women who were survivors of sexual sexual violence during the war, we started collecting testimonies, and suddenly the testimonies that collected UNMIC, because we said, okay, they will support us to find justice, they disappeared. Completely disappeared. We still don't have accountability, how they disappeared, where they are, nothing, all these years. But after the war, really, we tried to bring the support to the survivors of sexual violence, and it was completely ignorance, as I said, by UN, but let me tell you, also they were organizations, international and local, who misused the women for their own interests. The first organization, it was Medica Mondiale, that really started to support in a way to not just bring them together, but also to offer psychosocial support, health support, etc. slowly they were building other organizations and working in support, because we realized we have to, all these years, for 10 years, women's organization worked closely with survivors and completely preparing them for the next step, which is then they said we are ready to go and ask for legal now protection. So just to explain, in 2012, we organized the first protest in Kosovo, but it was not a protest organized by only us deciding. It was, first of all, as I said, the survivors said we are ready. Second, we went to Parliament Women. We said, we are going in the street. Will you support us? They said, yes. Next day, we will raise the issue in the Parliament. We went to media. We said, this is a very sensitive topic. Please, let's do it carefully. They said, yes. So we were really joining hands from other institutions in Kosovo. And March 8, 2012, we went in the street and we asked two things. We asked legal support for women and we asked the society to provide support as well. Not just legal support, but society support. Next day, the parliament organized the first session. It was the first session in the parliament to raise this issue. It was like the day before, we broke the wall of silence, and then they raised it there. Next step, it was media. Media was doing very sensitive TV programs together with organizations like Medica Kosova, who prepared all these years, not one day, all these years, for a decade, the women. And then they came on TV and spoke about the issue. And what is another beautiful thing is that many singers joined this initiative to support and to speak to society, to break the taboo, and they prepared songs that they were played on TV and they were played elsewhere. And the film that you're going to see this afternoon is one effort to work with the society to break the taboo among the people, which is Kosovo has very traditional culture. So, and like in many other countries, the rape during the war is not accepted in the culture. It's like something you keep it under. But these were the steps, and imagine all these steps. It was done slowly, carefully, but with lots of persistence, as Monica raised. We have been so persistent in our requests. We have been so patient with the process. And we are where we are now because the end, the most culminating, beautiful for the whole work is that we have a woman president who, from day one, she said, I'm going to support this. Tell us what to do. We said, you have to make a mechanism on top to find ways to work with government. And she organized a council, national council, and I will explain more what the council does, but the council brought together all actors, international, local institutions, local organizations, all actors. Let's sit and talk and coordinate, because coordinating was lacking all these years. If we have been coordinating better with UN agencies, with donors, with civil society, with government, today we will have a better situation. But as I said, we were persistent, patient. We are, it's not over, but we are still working on it.
Thank you so much, Igo, for showing, because you're actually describing a process for more than 10 years. Although it was in 5 minutes. And what I think is the key words are really, it's slowly, it's carefully, it's persistent and patient.
And coordinated.
And coordinated. But that's how you build women's agency to get recognized the injustices that have been done through all those times and how you claimed your share in participation. Thank you. I now turn to Danae. Because we have heard it several times today, widespread impunity is really one of the key challenges we face. And you are working both on local and international level. Why is it so difficult to address impunity? What are your strategies and processes? Please, Danae.
Thank you. It's an honor to have the opportunity to share some thoughts with you today. So just trial has a mandate to fight against impunity for international crimes, including enforced disappearance, torture, war crimes, crimes against humanity and genocide, and of course sexual violence. So we've got offices, just so that you know a little bit more who we are, in Geneva, Sarajevo in Bosnia, Kathmandu in Nepal, and recently in Bukavu in the DRC. And in all of those countries, we represent victims of sexual violence, in particular at the domestic level and also at the regional and international level. So I'm going to talk about impunity for conflict-related sexual violence. We've seen that throughout history, from Genghis Khan to Hitler, rape has been a feature of most conflicts. And we've also heard that, of course, rape doesn't, or sexual violence, doesn't end with the conflict, but has lasting effect long after the end of the conflict. So although, over the last 20 years, progress has been made and steps have been taken by the international community to address this issue, we need to realize that, of course, most perpetrators commit these crimes with total impunity. The consequences of impunity for this crime is that it exacerbates tension and undermines reconciliation effort, feeding a cycle of violence. And so combating impunity is not only about bringing justice for the victims, it is also about international security and stability. So we've talked a little bit about the challenges, we see that impunity is a very complex issue, and it has its roots in the number of problems, and we've discussed some of them already. So there's first, social issues of stigmatization, ostracizing, also linked to the fact that in many rural settings, there's a strong preference for traditional justice mechanisms. Procedures can be extremely slow and costly. Judicial personnel can be, underpaid and influenced by bribes and corruption. Access, security, witness protection issues are all very important and magnified when you're trying to undertake an investigation in the midst of conflict. So all of these factors have a direct impact on the ability to gather evidence. Often also there's a limited political will to address impunity. That's something that needs to be recognized. And it's often owing to the fact that perpetrators are state agents. So now we've discussed some of the challenges, I'd like to see what can be done to address impunity for sexual and gender-based violence and the minimum framework that you need to have in place. First, there's security, we've mentioned it before. Enhancing witness and victim protection is a sine qua non for reporting these crimes. Victims, lawyers, justice officials are very often threatened, so it is essential to ensure the security if you want victims to come forward and if you want judges to press charges despite a threat of retaliation. The second thing I wanted to mention was capacity. Successful prosecution requires good investigation. So before you can close the impunity gap, you need to close the capacity gap. There's still a very limited understanding of this type of crimes about justice official. So just to give you an example of trials work, we've just recently opened an office in the Democratic Republic of Congo, in the DRC, in South Kivu. And we're developing the pilot project, which aims at training and mentoring human rights defenders, lawyers, prosecutors, and judges, specifically on how to document and investigate sexual and gender-based crimes. Another problem that you have is that legal frameworks in conflict and post-conflict countries are often inadequate and they lag behind international norms. So it's important to continue to advocate for domestication of the Rome Statute, as well as the development of domestic laws, which ensure that rape and other forms of sexual violence, which amounts to torture, war crimes, or crimes against humanity, are criminalized at the domestic level as international crimes and not just as ordinary crimes. That these crimes are defined consistently with the highest international standards, that they are not subject to statutory limitation or prescription, and that they provide for command responsibility. As mentioned before, another key requirement to close the impunity gap is proper, you know, political will. The International Criminal Court operates on the principle of complementarity. This means that it will only come into play if states cannot prosecute domestically these crimes. So because of the mandate, the International Criminal Court and international tribunals can only deal with a very limited number of cases, and usually they will only look at cases involving high-ranking officials, not middle-level or lower-level perpetrators. So their work alone is not sufficient to close the impunity gap. It is therefore crucial that states comply with their primary responsibility to investigate and prosecute serious international crimes, including sexual and gender-based crimes. So in particular also, there should be better implementation at state level of existing international legal obligations. Just to give you an example of trials work and strategies in that spectrum, trial has developed litigation strategies which include the use of universal jurisdiction, and I'm not going to expand on that today, and also the use of regional and international human rights mechanisms, such as the UN treaty bodies, the European Court of Human Rights, the African Commission on Human and People's Rights. And we use these mechanisms to put pressure on domestic authorities so that they adapt the legislation and put them in line with international standards, and also to bring justice and reparation for the victims. So I'm just going to tell you the story of one of our clients. I'm going to call her Fatima. So Fatima is from Burundi, and she was 9 years old when an officer of the Burundian army who was patrolling her neighborhood kidnapped her, took her to his domicile, and raped her. Fatima's mother was shortly after abandoned by her husband because she refused an out-of-court settlement with the perpetrator. So she brought a criminal complaint against the perpetrator on behalf of her daughter, and the instructing magistrate recognized the veracity of the child's account, and there was a medical expert who confirmed that the child had been sexually assaulted. So far, so good. And despite all this evidence, at some point, the investigation was suddenly put on hold, and the case was simply dismissed. So what do you do next? So Burundi has ratified the Convention Against Torture, and these facts amount to torture. So Trial last year filed an individual communication against Burundi before the Committee Against Torture, alleging a violation of Burundi's legal obligation under the convention. So this is the first ever case of sexual violence against Burundi that has been filed before the Committee Against Torture. It's going to take a couple of, you know, at least a year or two, maybe more, to get a final answer. But if this leads to a condemnation, this child will finally get the justice and recognition that she deserves. And hopefully this will pave the way for a more successful prosecution at the national level. And one final point I wanted to make is that Trial has been and is working with victims of conflict-related sexual violence in many countries. And they all ask for the same thing, justice. So, you know, as Monica Hauser mentioned before, it's time to shift the stigma from the survivor to the perpetrator. And it's time to shatter the culture of impunity for these crimes and bring perpetrators to justice.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Danai, for this very interesting outline, particularly also reminding us what are so crucial things. It's about security for those working on trying to end impunity. It's about capacities that often are lacking. It's about having the legal frameworks, which often we don't, and the political will, which is missing. And I think this is very promising, the kind of strategies that you're trying with referring to universal justice or using national and international human rights mechanisms. So we're all very eager to see what follows with the Burundi case. Thank you. I turn now to Karen. I've stated it before, it's very important to integrate gender into peace building. But why actually? Could you outline a little bit? Why should gender-specific violence that happened during the conflict or in the aftermath be relevant for state building processes? What are the fields? What are the issues we're talking about? And what are the consequences if we fail to do so? Could you? You have the word.
Thank you, Ursula, and thank you for the opportunity to participate in this important event. So as we've been hearing from all of the other speakers, there are countless examples of egregious forms of sexual and gender-based violence in conflict zones around the world. But too often there's a failure to recognize that just because a negotiation might have started or a ceasefire has been agreed or a peace settlement has been signed, that this doesn't mean that there's an end to this form of violence. And indeed, we know that peacetime is often not a time of peace for women and girls. And so, as Ursula mentioned, I'm going to try and shift the focus a little bit now to why it matters for the state building and peace building processes that follow the end of a violent conflict and as countries are transitioning to peace, and the importance of using these as entry points to actually trying to address this continuum of violence that we've been hearing about. So I'm just going to briefly, Ursula also asked me to mention a little bit about the international framework for addressing state building and peace building, why it matters to these processes, and some examples of how we can take action. So since 2007, there has been growing recognition of the specific challenges facing fragile and conflict-affected states. We're seeing that they're failing on achieving all of the MDGs. They face specific challenges associated with the lack of institutional capacity and infrastructure and the legacy of violent conflict, and that we need to find new ways of delivering aid in these contexts. In response to this, the New Deal for International Engagement on Fragile States was signed between donor countries and conflict-affected countries in 2011. And the idea behind this is to create a new way of working together to end violent conflict and support peace and development. This New Deal introduces a number of new tools that are available to use to try and build peace and build states, such as improved tools for assessing fragility and conflict analysis, financial compacts to find innovative ways of financing development in these contexts, and also new ways of defining and measuring success in terms of peace and security. It's still very early days in the New Deal, but it is now being piloted in several countries, and I also think it's important to point out that the Swiss National Action Plan, in fact, mentions the New Deal, and I think this is very important because this is one of the few that actually makes the link between this New Deal state-building, peace-building focus process and the need to also advance gender equality in these contexts. But overall, a major oversight has been that gender equality features very little in the New Deal, unfortunately. And this is despite the fact that we had Resolution 1325 11 years previously. We've had several successor resolutions. There's a fairly strong women, peace, and security agenda, but this was not incorporated into the thinking and the implementation around the New Deal. And although there has perhaps been slightly more success in terms of raising the profile of gender issues in the context of peace building and women's participation in decision-making processes, state-building discourse has been very slow to respond to the need to integrate gender equality. And this is despite the fact that principles of legitimacy, inclusion, and accountability are key linchpins of state-building. If you don't have these values and you don't have these principles integrated into your institutions, they're not going to succeed, and you can't have them without gender equality. But equally, I think it's also important to say that because of the increased momentum and focus on sexual violence in conflict, there has also been a tendency to perhaps not consider adequately the impact of the continuum of sexual and gender-based violence post-conflict. So there's also a need for those working on sexual violence in conflict to engage with state-building and peace-building discourse. So I think basically there's a good argument for bringing these two agendas together. But why does it matter? Why is sexual and gender-based violence relevant to state-building and peace-building? As Ursula mentioned, it often gets pushed to the side. SGBV, broader gender equality issues, not important right away. You know, we need to get people to stop fighting, get institutions up and running. Let's deal with it later. Well, I think first and most importantly, SGBV is linked to the drivers of conflict. We've heard this already from other speakers. Structures of exclusion and discrimination, wider inequalities, and as Madame Bangura highlighted earlier, the link to economic dimensions of conflict and using sexual violence as a tool to control territory. This means that sexual and gender-based violence is a root of conflict, and therefore addressing it must be a part of any solution to conflict. And while SGBV exists at all times and across all societies, in fragile and conflict-affected states, it's part of this larger continuum of violence, and there are specific aspects of these contexts that can normalize and entrench and perpetuate SGBV. These include proliferation of small arms and light weapons, harmful militarized masculine identities, and the destruction of the social fabric that is part of and is a characteristic of many contemporary conflicts. All of these factors mean that it becomes embedded, and then it becomes an ever-present aspect of post-conflict societies and becomes very difficult to address and then undermines the prospect for peace. And we know that if root causes of conflict are not addressed, then peace-building efforts will fail and countries will relapse into conflict. So to really tackle the roots, it's clear that we really need to engage with sexual and gender-based violence as one of those roots. But sadly, this rarely happens. It's rarely considered as a measure of peace or security. We consider countries as peaceful and as secure, even when these practices are widespread and documented and visible, but we still think of these countries as happily moving on a path to peace. And so we need to also change the way we think about what makes a country peaceful and what makes a country secure. Other reasons, I think, why it's relevant, aside from being linked to the roots of conflict and, of course, an issue in its own right, we should address sexual and gender-based violence because it's a human rights issue, mainly affecting women and girls, but also men and boys. So fundamentally, that is a reason enough itself. But it also has an impact on development and state-building, peace-building outcomes. Research has shown, research the OECD has done, has shown that countries that have the highest levels of violence against women also have the highest rates of maternal mortality. And no coincidence that over half of these are also countries experiencing or coming out of civil conflict. And as I mentioned before, also the legitimacy and accountability and inclusion prerequisites for effective state building cannot be met without gender equality and without addressing sexual and gender-based violence. In terms of then what we do to address this, I think the New Deal offers an interesting framework that could be used to leverage efforts to address sexual and gender-based violence. The peace building and state building goals that were identified as part of the New Deal, there are five, and they are being put forward as new ways of assessing how far a country is along the transition to peace. And there are indicators associated with each of these goals. And I think each of these five areas offer opportunities to address sexual and gender-based violence. So just to run very quickly, I know there's not much time, but the first one, political inclusion. We know that this is a fundamental aspect of state building and peace building, but the reality is that negotiations and peace talks rarely include any kind of discussion around ending or addressing violence against women, building in accountability mechanisms, and ending impunity. So there's a real opportunity that if we can ensure that survivors can participate and have access to these spheres of influence where political institutions are being shaped, commissions are being set up, constitutions are being redrafted, all of these provide opportunities to put in clauses that go against impunity, that ensure that there will be accountability and action against sexual and gender-based violence. Justice and security are another two separate goals, and these are obviously very critical. While women face many of the same injustices and many of the same insecurities as men do in post-conflict contexts, they also face additional gender-specific ones, many of which are linked to SGBV and vulnerability to SGBV. So we could be using the opportunity to redefine what justice and security mean in post-conflict contexts. We could be working better with security and justice providers to ensure that they have the skills and the training needed to ensure that they can address sexual and gender-based violence, they can respond to the challenges. It can include legal reform to change the laws to ensure that a prosecution is possible against various forms of sexual violence, training of the police, and also importantly, very importantly, aligning, working to align informal justice and security systems with the more formal justice and security providers that the international community tends to work with. Often in many many fragile and conflict-affected countries, you have parallel systems where particularly issues relating to sexual violence are settled informally through either structures at the community or within the family, and this makes it very difficult to then ensure that there's proper services given to survivors and that they also get the justice that they deserve. So working to bring those systems more into line with international standards would be a positive step forward. The remaining two peace-building and state-building goals are economic foundations and revenues and services. So this deals with job creation, access to secure livelihoods, provision of services, and indeed how services are funded by governments. So we know that service delivery is a key element in addressing SGBV effectively and ensuring that women and girls can have access to the health, psychosocial, and other support that they need. So we need to ensure that when these services are being designed and funded, that it's being appropriately allocated also to the needs of women and girls survivors, and that the particular barriers that they may face will also be addressed by these processes. So I think it's clear that we need the participation, resources, and support of all members of society to ensure that state building and peace building are sustainable. But this is not happening for many reasons, which we may hopefully have an opportunity to go into in more detail. But I think it's just critical to point out that women play major roles in peace building and state building. They put their lives at risk every single day, working to build better countries, stronger institutions, and to have a secure livelihood for their families. But they do this at an immense personal cost, and often while facing various forms of sexual and gender-based violence and vulnerabilities, even in the supposed peacetime of post-conflict transitions. So I think we need renewed focus on state building and peace building and how SGBV can be addressed by these processes, not only to improve women's lives and their communities, but also just to make sure that these processes themselves are more legitimate and accountable.
Thank you, Karen, for this outline and showing that there is no real ground to divide questions of gender-based violence and state building, that actually we have enough principles, as you mentioned, inclusion, participation, accountability, where actually those questions link, and the question, as you said, what makes a country peaceful and what makes a country safe, to really reflect on that. So I have prepared second questions for you, but we are late in time. And I actually give you the floor to the public, and we might come to those we wanted, you might have, if you allow me. So I would like to thank you now all for your attention and actually give the floor now to the public for addressing questions, either to our panelists or also to Mrs. Bangura and Mrs. Hauser. If from the public, who would like to ask a question? And please, if you do so, please say your name and be brief. And we will see if we can also hand over the microphone. So whom could I give the floor? We have just here.
Yes, thank you very much. My name is Sidonia Gabriel. I'm from the Center for Peace Building at Swiss Peace. And I really, with great interest, listened to all of you and also to the speakers before. and actually, what always also now in my work, we do a lot of looking at these policy frameworks. Since I'm not working in the field anymore, but we had also heard about some experiences also from you, Igmo. My question is always, how can we actually link what we call these normative frameworks, like 1325, the New Deal, and address the complexities of reality. How do we get this on the ground? And Ibo, you had mentioned that in the beginning, when the UN mission arrived, you thought they will implement now 1325. This is a great chance. And it didn't happen. Does it happen today? How can you use in your work the framework, this normative framework? How does it help you?
Thank you. I might collect another one or two questions if there are. Who else want to break the ice? Courageous. One in the back.
Good afternoon. Well, my question maybe is a bit...
Can you say your name,
please? Okay, my name is Gina Marcela. I am representative of the Embassy of Colombia. Especially my question is regarding to the process of peace that we are living now. I would like to ask to all of you, I don't know, you are have a lot of experience, and I would like to ask about how help the victims of sexual violence in the process of dwell. In Colombia now we are in a process of peace, we have a lot of victims, and we have also victims of violence against a woman. So I would like to know how helped them in this process of dwell, and how to help to the reconciliation, just in the victims, especially just that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. So it's about how to support women in this peace process to bring the topic on the agenda. Yeah. Is that correct?
Like how reconcile the victims with themselves, you know, to okay. continue do in a process of resilience in a positive way.
Just okay, in okay. process to overcome.
Yeah, the yeah. Okay. Process.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Is there another question just right now? Otherwise, I would like to give you back for now. We have this first question of Sidonia, Gabriel. How can we link these normative frameworks with the complexity of reality? Do you have maybe concrete examples? It was also the question in Kosovo. Is it better now after first experiences? Maybe Igor, you can answer, and then maybe some others also can bring good examples of how we can link.
Hmm? I'll be very short. Does it happen today? Is the resolution implemented by force? Because they have to. We still have UNMIC in Kosovo, but they are not administering Kosovo because since 2008 we have independence. But we still have a mission there, and SRSG is very conservative, and he's doing things because he's pushed. For example, he's organizing Open Day because he's pushed by headquarters. He's just following what they're saying. But it's a huge difference between headquarters and missions. Huge difference. Whenever I went to New York, I was like, wow. There is hope. And then I go back home and I'm like, oh my God, I just came from New York. Can you please listen? So then we have ULEX, completely gender blind, completely gender blind. They were after rule of law fighting in Kosovo, corruption and everything. And guess what? We just found out that we have ULEX persecutors involved in what corruption. And just last, there cannot be really reconciliation without justice. Imagine in 2006, when women, because we work with Women's Network in Serbia, Kosovo Women's Network, when Women's Network in Serbia, Women in Black, they publicly, in a meeting together, they said, we ask for apologies in our name, what happened to you. Imagine how much tears were in that room, and media showed that, because we have really good cooperation with media in Kosovo. We have two women who are leading TV national stations, and people were crying, and it was happening some healing, and we were praised by the whole people. How you women are working on this? It's amazing. And guess what? In Serbia, Women in Black were attacked.
Okay, thank you. You would like to answer, Mrs. Bangura, some of these questions?
No, I want to talk about the normative framework.
I talk now, somebody who's been a Minister of Foreign Affairs in my country, I was a civil society activist, and now actually I'm an international civil servant. I think the reality we have to accept, the UN cannot solve those problems. The countries where the crimes are being committed have the primary moral and legal responsibility to protect their citizens. We can adopt as many Security Council resolutions as we can. If we don't find a way how to convert those resolutions into solutions on the ground, we will not be able to solve the problem. When I took the job and I realized that we've had about 1325 laid the foundation, 1820 the conceptual framework, 1888 the infrastructure, and 1960 the element of compliance. We have the global legal framework, but we cannot move forward if we don't make sure these things are domesticated, like you said, the language you use on the ground. So the priorities, my colleague, my predecessor, Margot, stated five priorities: ending impunity, empowering and supporting the victims, strengthen political will, making sure the UN coordinates and works in a coherent way, and five, ensuring that sexual violence is seen as a weapon of war. I came and I put number six, ensuring national ownership, leadership, and responsibility. And I said, New York is not going to solve sexual violence. We have to go down in the countries. And I started working with leaders and talking to them, engaging them, and telling that this is not a problem by the UN. This is a problem that belongs to member states. It is only when you agree to solve the problem, it will be solved. And we started going into joint framework with government. So I visit a country, I said to them, you have a problem. This is your problem. My job is to help you address the problem. Before we can move forward, we need to have an agreement. And of course, the agreement takes into consideration the Security Council resolution, which says, you do this, I do that. And I said, like I said to President Kabila, I said, I am a former Minister of Foreign Affairs. I don't lead from the front. You are the president. This is your country. You have to deal with this problem. My job is to bring the international community behind your back. And I tell you, within the last 2 years I've worked in the DRC, I addressed the Senate, the whole Senate. There was a special session. And I told them their responsibility. Today, the Senate of the DRC has a commission working on sexual violence. I said to the president, you need to appoint one particular person to bring everything together. And the president has appointed a personal representative on sexual violence and groomment of children. I said to the Ministry of Defense, you have to develop a plan of action. Every leader in the military, from the lowest unit to the highest unit, has to take responsibility. If your people under your command commit sexual violence, you will be affected, and the military should take action on you. They signed, they develop a plan of action themselves. And we are supporting it. The military, everybody. So the important issue we have to remember, this is not a problem that is going to be solved by the UN. I think the reality is on the ground. I have worked as a civil society leader, and I can tell you when I was in Sierra Leone, there are meetings and there are conferences where we're not included. I go into those meetings and I take control and I have my end result. And so the important issue is how to build the capacity on the ground, how you work with the government. You said in your discussion when you spoke, I mean, in a country like Cote d'Ivoire, rape is not a crime. It's a crime against the moral. It's not a crime against the person. In Burundi, if you're raped and you make a complaint in the police, to the police, the procedure, as we know, those of you who have worked in Africa, until the case goes to trial, the perpetrator is put in a police station. The victim feeds that perpetrator until the perpetrator can be taken to prison. If he stays in the police station for 2 weeks, you provide food for him, because the police will tell you they don't have a budget to feed him. These are the basic challenges. So it is important we can talk at that level, at the UN. We can pass all the Security Council resolutions, but those resolutions will never succeed until on the ground we make sure we take the action that needs to be taken, we build their capacity, we support them, we make sure they domesticate, and that's our job. So that's why for me and my colleagues, UN Action and the others, we spend more time in the countries. In Somalia, my first victim, which I heard of when I heard a woman had been raped, her husband was arrested. The human rights officer reporting it was arrested. The journalist was arrested. The social worker didn't report. They were all arrested and thrown in prison. I did a press release. The Secretary General did a press release. The president abandoned us, ignored us. But I realized he was coming to Europe to sell Somalia, to raise funds for Somalia. I got in touch with the State Department. Hillary is a champion. When he came out of the plane, he landed in, at the State Department. Hillary said, why did you arrest that woman? You better go and release her, else you are not talking. He went to the White House. Obama raised it. He said, I can't interfere with justice, which is the usual language you use. The independence of the judiciary, that's what you tell us. Okay. He went to down the street. William Agos waiting for him there. And he went to the European Union. And our colleague, the representative for democracy and human rights, was waiting for him. So the president of the European Union said to him, what happened to these people you arrested on sexual violence? The poor guy realized, no way, I can't compete with this. He went back, they released the women. Today, I can say to you, the president of Somalia signed an agreement with the deputy secretary general of the United Nations to deal with sexual violence. We have an action plan. They produce their own action plan. So that's it. And I think that's where the second phase of our work is. We've got all the resolutions. But how do we take these resolutions and turn them into solutions from the national, international to the national level? That's where our work is, and that's why we're here, to be able to make sure we support that, to ensure national ownership, leadership, and responsibility. We have to hold them responsible, and we have to make sure they have committed. They are members of the United Nations, they are members of the African Union, and at that level, we also have to put pressure. So we work at the international, the regional level, the sub-regional level, and at the national level. That's where we can have results. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Bangura. That is almost already like a final, a final statement. So I give the chance, if are more questions around, maybe she will have another final statement afterwards. So you, it's up to you. Because we have 5 minutes left.
So my name is Mehdi Künzli, and I'm co-president of the Swiss Gay Federation and also of queer organization. And I might maybe have a stupid question, but lately I was concerned with this issue of gender inequality, and I think sexual violence is based on gender inequality. And actually, I didn't hear about the link between the activities that are done in against gender violence in conflicts and gender equality in general. And as we know, our world is mostly patriarchal constructed. And how could we change this violence? Because we can't change this violence, as this violence is patriarchal. And how we can change this violence with gender equality. Mm-hmm. Because there's a lot of other persons, it's not only women who are suffering from this sexual violence, there's also transgender people, there is also homosexual people and intersexual people who are suffering the same violence.
Thank you. So it's the question about gender equality even in a more comprehensive way, not only men and women, but other sexual and gender orientation. Is there another question from the public? And then I give this back to the panel. Or
thank you. My name is Anna Kutschenbacher, and I work for the Institute for Inclusive Security. We are a US-based American nonprofit. And my question relates to that and may sound even a little naive after the remarks of Madam Bangura, but it was mentioned several times, you know, that sexual violence also affects men and boys. But when it comes to the experience, when the conflict is over in communities and so, or cases in the media that are reported, this is usually then about women. So I was wondering if anybody can talk a little bit, you know, what happens to men who try to bring this to trial, if they do, or what happens if they if this gets visible or known in their communities.
Thank you. There's no other question. I would actually like these two questions, and I think we might can take them together and give first the panelists here to respond to that, those who wish, and then I might give a final word to Mrs. Bangura. I don't know, Ursula, would you like to say how you deal with men in your program, or men in different as victims or as partners in your fight?
Yes,
very briefly, because
so we don't have really experience in our program men bringing their cause or to trial, mm-hmm. but we have experience in the program men expressing that they have been victims, direct victims, it means being raped by perpetrators, or witnessing violence done to their women or boys who have to look how their mothers have been raped, and even boys who have been forced to rape their mothers, either to penetrate with objects or a direct rape. So then this experience, it shows that it's very, very difficult for boys and men to talk about that. It's even more difficult to talk about what happens to them. They are deeply ashamed, and we try in our community approach actually to bring different groups together, men together, boys together, victims of non-victims, and discussing what is their understanding of violence, of sexual violence, and what is their experience with violence and sexual violence. So they are talking from their own, what they have experienced by themselves. And I'm actually quite surprised if they are put together, they really arrive to talk about it. Of course, men are as well implicated in other ways, more as actors of change. The program is working as well a lot with couples, because domestic violence roots are often coming of conflicts in couples. And there, the exchange between, or giving the space as well to men to expressing their point of view, or to express what is pushing them to violence, is one of the crucial points to work together with them. But as I said, maybe one of you have experience with men really putting their cause to court.
Yeah, maybe Dana, maybe you respond.
Just very briefly, we have amongst our, you know, the client and the people we're working with, we do have men who have been victim of rape, and usually, you know, we as part of our trainings, for instance, we work with lawyers, and we try to raise the awareness about the fact that gay men, for instance, or transgender, you know, in many countries, of course, you know, the taboo is so big that they can be victim of sexual violence, and that it can qualify as torture. And we use the same strategies. But it's true that even when you talk with, you know, lawyers or human rights defenders, usually that's not something they're very familiar with or very comfortable to deal with. So there's a lot of work to do on that side.
Thank you. Ego, how
very,
about
very short, very
men
short.
As victims?
Very short, I know the rules. it's important that for all international organizations who go to post-conflict countries to not make just a program for women and children. I've been screaming in Kosovo, how about men and boys? And with my organization previously that I worked with, I worked in rural areas, and immediately after the war, I brought some experts from America, friends of mine, who have an organization that work with traumatized men. Trust me, in that region, it was not really, it was so small numbers of violence at home and violence in general. And other parts, and it was no interest to work. Always victims are women and children after the war. So that should change. Men should be in the program. And just to say, after the war, we've seen more violence against gay and transgender people in Kosovo, and also because of rise of radical religious groups. Recently, we have rising the group, this extremist. We are 90% Muslim people in Kosovo, but we have now group rising called it's like Wahhabis, and they are so much against any gay organization. And we have three, but luckily now government finally opened their eyes and put some in jail because they promoted even hate speech and encouraged people to go and fight. And just for the end, I never said about UN that they should solve the problem. I only said that they, UN New York, should monitor and make accountable their missions. I didn't say they should solve our problems. Thank you.
Karen, would you like to answer briefly?
It's okay.
Okay. Because then I would actually give the possibility, Mrs. Bangura, you have a final word, or Mrs. Hauser. Would you? Would you like to? You're very welcome. To give the final statement.
Thank you very much. With regards to the relationship between gender equality and sexual violence in conflict, I just say one word. A society that does not respect its women in peacetime will not protect them in conflict. There is no way you can avoid that. So that, for me, is a fundamental principle, and that's what we have seen. In the countries where we have increased sexual violence in conflict, we go back and look at the issue of gender equality, and you can see that there was no respect for women during the peacetime. So I think that one is plain and simple. On the issue of sexual violence against men and boys, I do agree the majority are women and most people, but we have changed that in the UN. If you look at our reports, I'm talking to you this year and the report last year, you can see that one of the things we name as one of the things we have realized is sexual violence against men and boys. Last year in July, we had a first conference in the United Nations. Anybody who wants can talk to Nadine, we'll send you the reports of sexual violence against men and boys. It's there, it's happening, I'm seeing it in Syria. But one of the most interesting aspects we've seen, it happens mostly in detention facilities, during interrogation, in house searches, at checkpoints. That's why it happens. So it's used as an interrogation technique. A lot of it is happening in Syria. So obviously we have come to realize, I just came back from a conference, to be able to understand that we had to work with male survivors of sexual violence in the United States. I just came from their 14th annual conference, and they gave me an award for international outreach program. For us, it's a very important issue. It's there, but I think what I have learned, that's my own personal opinion, it's always been there, but hidden under the name torture. It's hidden inside that thing on torture. So wherever you see torture against men, you look deeper, you will find out it's sexual violence against men and boys. In Bosnia, when I went there, it was never in all of the reports in Bosnia, but I met a man who was raped, and he was forced to rape his son. So it's there, it's happening, and I think we have realized that. The challenge we have in the UN, again, I agree what you said, when the Women, Peace and Security mandates was created, the departments or the units or the agencies that are working as response in terms of medical and psychosocial support are agencies predominantly working on women, UNICEF, UNFPA. So we still, as an international community, need to put in place the mechanism to respond to men and boys. We don't have that. And that's our biggest challenge. And for me, that's the way forward. We have to think about how do we respond to them? How do we provide medical and psychosocial support? You can't send a man and a boy to a gynecologist. It's not possible. Last and not the least, they are facing enormous challenges because of the backlash we have in Africa. I went to Uganda, I met a lot of victims, men victims of sexual violence, you know, from Burundi, from Rwanda, from Eritrea, from the DRC. They cannot go to hospital because as soon as you go to an hospital, the next thing is they call the police, they say he's gay. They call the police, and because there is a law against homosexuality in Uganda, these people are arrested and detained and claim to be gay. So these are some of the challenges that we're facing. We don't have the answers, we're working to deal with it, and we need all your support. Because when I took the position and raised the alarm and continued to raise the alarm, I have to be honest with you, I was challenged by a lot of women who said, oh, now you want the men to take our agenda from us. This is a woman issue. And that's a challenge. And I think that's where we all have to realize this is an issue against women, girls, men, and boys. And we have to find the space for these men and boys so we could be able to respond to them to provide the support that they need. So it's a challenge, it's there, and we have to work for it. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mrs. Bangur. This was the final word. We have taken even more time. It just remains to me to thank you all, for panelists, for being with us, for the interesting contribution, and the three speakers, Mr. Sager, Mrs. Bangura, and Ms. Hauser. Thank you so much, and all the public that you stayed on. You're all invited now for the reception. Thank you very much.